All right. Thank you so much, Joey. That's awesome. Well, happy Easter. He is risen. Have you heard? That's good news. The Lord is risen. And Joey read that story for us so beautifully and taught me how to pronounce the name Salome. So thank you. I never knew that. That's awesome. Hey, so glad you're here today. My name's Daniel. I'm one of the pastors. And it's my privilege to be able to share a little bit of the resurrection story with you today. Once again, I want to welcome you if you're new here or you're visiting or it's your first time in a long time. We are so glad that you're here today. And I love the worship in the round, but I want to get closer to you. But the speakers are going to yell at me, so if the speakers squeak, just tell me to go back because I might get a little excited this morning because it's a great, great day to celebrate that Jesus is alive. Now, how many of you last week, if you were here, I did a little poll to find out how many of you like to go shopping. We did that. We're not gonna revisit that. But what I want to know today is how many of you like surprises. Where are my surprise people out? You love surprises. Okay, we got quite a few. How many of you absolutely hate surprises? You would much rather know something's coming. You don't like to be surprised. Don't put up someone else's hand. Okay. Right, some of us absolutely hate surprises. I'm someone who loves surprises. My wife, not so much. She would rather look forward to something, know what's happening. I want to be taken off guard and whisked away. On my 40th birthday, I know what you're thinking. It's hard to imagine that I'm 40, but it's true. On my 40th birthday, Becky threw me an epic surprise party. And I thought that I was going over to my sister's house in Virginia to just have dinner with my family. And when I got there, the place was absolutely packed. So many of our friends from that season of our life were there. And it was just an incredible, incredible surprise. And I felt so loved. I enjoyed it. But looking back, I was a little disappointed. I didn't figure it out. Because there were lots of clues. There were lots of signs that something was going on. I'd walk into the room and all of a sudden Becky would quickly put her phone down. And I'm like, what's going on? You know, there'd be all these different things happening. She would say something and almost let it slip. So time and time again, there were these clues, but I just missed them because I wasn't expecting a surprise party. But once I got there and I enjoyed that surprise party, I could look back and I could see all of these clues. All of these things that I previously had missed were so painfully obvious now. But in the moment, right, in the moment, they didn't make any sense. The dots didn't connect in my head what was going on. And I can't help but wonder if Jesus' disciples felt the same. You see, Jesus, when he lived on this earth, he was the Son of God who took on flesh. The Bible tells us that he loved us so much that he left his home in heaven and he came down to our planet to live and dwell with us because he wanted to be with us so badly, he left everything behind. And the Bible tells us that when he was there, he was teaching his disciples week in and week out, and he told these guys, here's the thing about the disciples. How many of you know that God sometimes chooses stupid people to follow him? Look at your neighbor and say, you're one of them. No, be kind. It's Easter, right? God doesn't always choose the sharpest people, right? But here's the deal. The disciples totally missed that the resurrection was coming. Even though Jesus told them, not once, not twice, but in good old King James Version English, thrice. Three times Jesus told his disciples that he must suffer and die, and then he would be buried, and on the third day he would rise again. But even when Jesus was crucified, the disciples didn't piece the clues together. They weren't aware that what Jesus had previously said would happen was in fact happening in this precise moment of their lives. In fact, when Jesus was crucified, the disciples were so disheartened, they felt like all hope was absolutely lost. You see, these men had followed Jesus for the last 3 years. They had left absolutely everything to follow him. They had followed him on the dusty streets and they watched him perform countless miracles. And yet, they didn't recognize that what Jesus said would happen was actually happening in that moment. They were very surprised. If you have your Bibles, We're going to look at a story in John chapter 20. And as I see Sue has put this wonderful slide on the screen, you can't really blame the disciples, right, for not expecting a resurrection, because typically dead people stay dead, right? That's kind of normally what happens. When someone dies, they typically stay dead. And that's what the disciples expected would happen to Jesus. They thought that he too would stay dead. They didn't know that a resurrection was coming. They thought hope was lost. They thought the story was over. They had desperately wanted Jesus to be the Messiah. They thought that he would be the Savior who would come and save their nation. But in this moment, they realized they must have been wrong, because Jesus was crucified. He was hung on a tree. And surely the God of this world would never allow his Messiah to suffer such a gruesome death. I'm okay. All right, John chapter 20, here we go, verse 1. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. Now, this is coming from a story by one of the eyewitness accounts of Jesus' life. The Apostle John is writing this, and he's writing this story. And we have four different accounts in our Christian Bible: Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and they all tell this story. And in fact, we know that when the ladies were going to the tomb that morning, they were going to anoint Jesus' body for burial, because when he had died on Good Friday, they had to hastily prepare him and stick him in a tomb because the Sabbath was coming. And so the day after the Sabbath, when they were allowed to work again, they went to prepare him. So Mary gets there, and she sees that the stone has been removed from the entrance. Verse 2, so she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved. All right, just to point out, John is writing that about himself. So when you read in the Gospel of John that there was a disciple that Jesus loved, John's like, yeah, that was me. That's how he referred to himself. So he said, the disciple that Jesus loved said, they have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him. So remember now, Mary followed Jesus closely. She was one of his dear friends. But even Mary was surprised by the resurrection. Even Mary wasn't expecting it. In fact, she assumed what you would have assumed, what I would have assumed if we were there that day. She assumed that someone must have stolen Jesus' body. Because what other explanation could there be? Because dead people typically stay dead. That's right. Dead people typically stay dead. But here it is. So she's saying, we don't even know where Jesus' body is, and we don't even know who the they is that took him, but we know that they have done something with Jesus, because Jesus was dead, was buried, and now he's not there. And so check this out, verse 3. We keep the story going. So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. All right, they're not just going to take Mary's word for it, right? How many of you know you've been in that moment of grief, and you just feel like you have to do something? So here's Peter and John, who are discouraged, who are disheartened, who are full of despair because Jesus, who they thought was the Messiah, is suddenly dead and no more. And all of a sudden, Mary comes and says they've stolen his body. So Peter, always the impulsive one, and John, the one who loved Jesus, decide to sprint to the tomb. So they go running for the tomb because they have to check it out for themselves. They're not taking Mary's word for it. Typical men, right? We're not just going to take your word. We're going to go check it out. All right. So both were running. But watch this now. Both were running. But the other disciple, the one that Jesus loved, of course, right, outran Peter and reached the tomb first. Now keep in mind, this is talking about John. John is highlighting the fact that as him and Peter ran for the tomb, he got there first. I don't know what bearing that has on the gospel story, but John wants you to know that he's faster than Peter, okay? He got there first, and he bent over, and he looked in. He didn't go into the tomb. He looked in the tomb at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him. Okay, in case you missed it, he's pointing out again that Simon got there after me. He came behind him, and Simon again was the impulsive one. He goes straight into the tomb, all right? And so he runs straight in there. Let me see where I am. Okay, then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. So all of a sudden it's, okay, now they didn't just steal his body, but why would they unwrap the cloths and fold them up and leave them in the tomb? All right, this is a bit curious. Okay, what's happening? It says finally in verse 8, the other disciple, in case you missed it, who got there first? In case you didn't hear it the first time. The other disciple who got there first also went inside, and now he saw and believed. John had a good opinion of himself, right? He saw and believed, but look what's in parentheses in the next verse. But they still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus must raise from the dead, must rise from the dead. They saw the empty tomb, and even the empty tomb that Jesus told his disciples they would find, they still didn't believe there was a resurrection. And maybe you're here this morning, and maybe you don't come to church that often, or maybe it's been a long time since you've been to church. And maybe you also have some trouble believing the story that this dude Jesus lived and died and came back to life after 3 days. If you sometimes struggle to believe the resurrection is real, I want you to know today that you are in great company. Even Jesus' closest friends didn't believe it initially when they saw the empty tomb. When they saw it, they assumed someone must have stolen his body, because dead people stay dead. They don't come back to life. And so the disciples themselves, the followers of Jesus, whose letters we now have collected in this incredible book we call the Bible, their letters document their own disbelief. In each account, nobody's saying, when I got to the tomb, I knew Jesus would be alive. No, nobody believed that. None of his disciples, none of his closest friends. In fact, what you could say is this: nobody expected nobody. See what I did there? Nobody expected there to be nobody. Everyone thought that Jesus would stay dead until he wasn't. Until they encountered him alive, after they had seen him die, after they had seen him crucified and hung on a tree and buried in a tomb. It wasn't until they saw with their own eyes that Jesus was still alive that they connected the dots. You see, the disciples were a little bit slow. And that means that you and I have hope. Because no matter how stubborn or slow we are, we can recognize that Jesus is alive. Not just because it's a story we were told in Sunday school. Not just because it's something we grew up hearing. But because there are eyewitness accounts, men and women who follow Jesus and saw him crucified, saw him buried, and then saw him come back to life. Now, let me show you one more verse because it's awesome. You want to read it? No, okay. All right, Luke, if you have your Bibles again, Luke chapter 24. Ooh, okay. Here we go. You guys are going to like this one. Okay, here we go. All right, now this is a little bit funny, but I'm not going to give a lot of commentary here because I value my life. But I want us to see this. So let me read this passage quickly to you. Luke 24. On the first day of the week, this is another account. Now, let me tell you this about Luke real quick. Luke was not one of Jesus' disciples who originally followed him. He was a physician. He was a doctor. And he actually set out to examine all this stuff about Jesus because he had heard the story of Jesus. He had heard about people who saw him a dead and come back to life. So Luke set out to thoroughly investigate the matter and to see if what Jesus claimed about himself was true. And he wrote this account in our New Testament called the Gospel of Luke. He also wrote the book of Acts about how the church was born. Okay, so here's what he found out. He said, on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took spices they prepared and went to the tomb. And they found the stone had been rolled away from the tomb. But when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. Remember, they were expecting a body because nobody expected nobody. Okay. And while they were wondering about this, can you imagine the thoughts going on in their minds? Where did they take Jesus? Like, he's gone. What happened? In their fright, the women bowed down after while they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. I tried to get that outfit for today, not on Amazon, okay. But in their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground, and the men said to them, why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen. Remember, right? Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee, the Son of Man must be delivered over to the hands of sinners, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again. And then they remembered his words. And when they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the others. And it was Mary Magdalene and Joanna and Mary, the mother of Jesus, the mother of James, and the others of them who told this to the apostles. But here's the verse I want you to get. Verse 11. But they did not believe the women because their words seemed to them like nonsense. I ain't gonna talk about it, okay? But they didn't believe the women, because their words seemed like nonsense. And again, this is where Peter then once again takes off and runs for the tomb because he has to see for himself. You see, they weren't expecting this. This was the biggest surprise party of all time. The disciples thought Jesus was dead, buried, gone. But then all of a sudden, he who was dead comes back to life. And because he lives, we have hope for tomorrow. Because he lived, we believe that we are given a second chance at life because of what he's done for us. And so it was all of these eyewitnesses. It was all of these people, Matthew, Mark. Mark, it was the guy who wrote down Peter's account of Jesus' life. You have Luke. We have a whole list of these witnesses. How about James, the brother of Jesus? James, the brother of Jesus, believed that his brother was the Messiah. If you have a brother, let me ask you this question. What would it take for you to believe that your brother was the Son of God? Right? I mean, James, the very brother of Jesus, believed it, and he wrote about it, and he testified about it. And it was all of these eyewitness accounts that give us the sense and the belief that Jesus truly did come back from the dead. And maybe you're here this morning, and you're not sure if you really buy everything written in the Bible. Maybe you have questions about some of the stories written in Scripture. Well, I have good news for you. The Bible came after this event, all right? The Bible that we have today, the Bible in its full form with the Jewish scriptures and these accounts of Jesus' life and the apostles' teaching came 350 years after the resurrection. And that's important because I want you to understand the center of our faith is not the Bible. It's an event. It's the resurrection of Jesus. Now, I fully believe in the authority and the authenticity of Scripture. I've based my life on it. I will continue to do so. But in the end, the center of our faith as followers of Jesus aren't all the stories in the Bible. It's the resurrection. It's that Jesus lived and died and came back to life for you and for I. And I believe everything in the Bible points us to this moment. All of the Jewish scriptures point towards Jesus. All of the letters help us understand his teaching. But at the end, the center of our faith is an event. It's this moment in history that changed everything. Remember what happened to the disciples. They ran and hid. They ran and hid after Jesus died because they were afraid of the Jewish leaders. And these same disciples who once ran and hid, once Jesus appeared to them after he was dead, they became bold and courageous, and they preached the gospel, even though it meant that they themselves would be imprisoned, tortured, and killed. These same men who once were hiding, days later become the most courageous people around because they saw their king alive. Because they saw it with their own eyes. And all of a sudden, they were completely changed. Because the resurrection changed everything for them. And in the same way, the resurrection can change everything for us. Because Jesus loved us so much that he came and he lived and died for us. And when he came back from the dead, that was our promise that we too will rise and spend eternity with him in heaven. That's how much Jesus cares about us. That's how much he loves you. That's the length he went through for you. This Easter, our theme is very simple. It's love is risen. And we don't have confidence in God because everything always works out for us the way we want it to. we have confidence in God because Jesus died and came back to life and love was risen for you and for I. You see, Jesus is love. He's an exact representation of his Father in heaven, and he loves us deeply and desperately. I want to invite the band worship team to come back, and we're gonna go back into a moment of worship. But while we do that, I just want to encourage you, if this story of the resurrection is unfamiliar to you or new to you, or maybe you've heard it, but you've not ever really believed it and bought into it, here's what I would suggest for you today. If someone can predict their own death and resurrection and then pull it off, it might be worth listening to what they have to say, right? Jesus predicted his own death and resurrection, and then he actually pulled it off. And he did that for you, and he did that for me. Because you see, there's something in our culture we don't like to talk about anymore. And that's the fact that the Bible tells us that all of us are sinners. We've all made mistakes. We've all done bad things, whether it's lying or gossip or slander or lust or a combination of these or something worse. We've all missed the mark of God's standard for us. But rather than leaving us isolated and abandoned in our wrong, God loved us so much that he sent his one and only son to live and die for us. And when Jesus went to the cross on Good Friday, love was given. He willingly sacrificed his life to pay the penalty for your sin. And 3 days later, Jesus rose from the dead. And when he came back, that was the sign of the eternal promise that you and I, who have faith in Jesus, will also have eternal life with him one day. Paul wrote this to the church in Rome. He said, if we believe in our hearts and confess with our mouths that Jesus is Lord, we will be saved. The Bible tells us that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. And that God made him, talking about Jesus, who had no sin, to be sin for us. So that in him, you and I could receive forgiveness and eternity with him. And so I just want to pray with you. If you're here and you feel that pull in your heart, you feel like these scriptures are stirring something inside of you, and maybe you've never made a commitment to follow Jesus before, let me just pray with you now. And I'm going to ask everyone to pray after me. It's as simple as believing in our hearts and confessing with our mouth that Jesus lived and died for us. If we believe that, if we invite Jesus into our life, the Bible promises that he will come in and be our Savior and our Lord, and we are guaranteed eternity in heaven, not because of how good we are, but because of how good he is. Not because of anything we could do, but because of what he did for us in his life, death, and resurrection. So if you feel the Lord tugging your heart today, I want to pray. I'm going to invite everyone to pray out loud with me, just so that we're all in this together as a church family. Dear Lord, thank you for sending your son, Jesus. Jesus, I believe that you came down to this earth and you died on the cross to take the place for me. You paid the price for my wrongdoing. And Jesus, I now invite you to come and be the Lord of my life. I believe that on the third day you rose again. May I experience your new life today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Hey, if you've prayed that and you really meant it and believed it in your heart, and maybe it's the first time you've ever invited the Lord to come in, or maybe you've wandered away and you've come back, in a few moments, we're going to do baptisms. And baptism is a beautiful picture of us identifying with Jesus in his death and resurrection. As we go down into the water, we're buried with him, and we come up to newness of life. If you're here today and you've never been baptized in water, and you're a follower of Jesus, whether because you just became one right now or because you've been following him for years but you've never gotten around to this act of obedience, I'm going to invite you to make a decision to get baptized today. We have some extra towels available. The water is nice and freezing. Don't let it stop you. Don't let it stop you. If you would like to be baptized and you weren't planning on it already, where's Don? Don's over here. Come see Don during this song, if that's you, and we will make room and space for you to celebrate a public declaration of your faith today. Will the rest of you stand? Let's get on our feet. Let's continue to worship our Lord because he has risen from the dead.